early symptoms of scleroderma often present with something called Raynaud's phenomenon. Raynaud's, it involves spasm of the blood vessels, usually in the periphery, meaning in the hands or feet, during exposure to cold temperatures, changes in relative temperature, or exposure to stressful events. And during a Raynaud's episode, patients will develop discoloration of their fingers or toes, or both, and the discoloration is usually initiated by an onset of pallor or white color of the fingers, which is often followed by blue discoloration, and finally with a blushing of the fingers. So that's one of the most common early signs. Associated with Raynaud's is something called a digital ulcer. It doesn't happen in everybody. Only about half of patients ever get these ulcers in scleroderma, but they can be very painful and they affect the very distal tip of the fingertip. You can also have little indentions, like a little pencil poked into the end of the finger, and they can be painful. Raynaud's is definitely the most common first sign of scleroderma, but it can also be associated with many other autoimmune diseases, such as thyroid disease, other connective tissue diseases. It even can be associated with non-connective tissue diseases, so it's definitely not specific. But it is seen in about 93% to 95% of our patients, so it's common in our population. Other early signs of scleroderma can include gastroesophageal reflux disease, although this is again very common in the general population, and so it's seen in many patients without scleroderma. Other early signs can include puffy fingers. Patients will often not be able to wear their rings that they've worn for many years before, and this is in the absence of high sodium intake or significant weight gain. Some of the signs and symptoms of diffuse scleroderma, the biggest distinguishing feature includes the skin thickening that can occur on the upper arms, thighs, chest, and abdomen. This is different from limited scleroderma, as those areas of skin are definitely not involved. And because the skin thickening can affect more proximal areas of the body, many patients with diffuse scleroderma often have trouble moving larger joints, such as the shoulders and hips, from early on in their disease. This can cause significant disability. In addition, many patients with diffuse scleroderma will also have involvement of muscles and muscle weakness, and muscle disease can be inflammatory or fibrotic in scleroderma. This can be a big problem for patients with diffuse disease. Patients with diffuse disease can also be affected by interstitial lung disease or fibrosis of the lungs, by kidney involvement or scleroderma renal crisis, and they can also have something called pulmonary hypertension. CREST is a subtype of limited scleroderma. It's spelled just like it sounds, C-R-E-S-T, and it's an acronym that stands for calcinosis, Raynaud's phenomenon, esophageal dysmotility, sclerodactyly, and telangiectasias. Now, the calcinosis typically involves an inflammatory lesion in the skin where you can have the deposition of calcium or white fluid or crystals that can be quite painful and often occur in the elbow or on the knees, sometimes in the hands. The second one we discussed before was Raynaud's phenomenon, followed by esophageal dysmotility, which is essentially gastroesophageal reflux disease involving slowing of the movement of the esophagus. Sclerodactyly is the S in CREST, and it is describing skin thickening of the fingers. And telangiectasias are small dilated post-capillary venules that appear as red spots on the skin, most commonly seen on the face, inner lip, mouth, palms of the hands, and chest. And so these are all features that are associated with CREST. Now, in order to be diagnosed with CREST, you generally need 3 out of 5 of those features.